Thank you, Christine, for that wonderful introduction. And thank you all for coming today. about my research. So the song that you heard just now is a song by my favorite artist, India Ari. And the song really speaks about how poverty exists throughout the world. And it speaks about the interconnectedness and interdependence of all people. And that's the main theme that I am trying to convey with my presentation today. Though I'm speaking about child malnutrition in India, I'm really talking about human suffering throughout the world, which is an issue that's relevant to all of us. And within the next half hour, I want to present this presentation as a call to action to all of you. I hope that I can inspire and motivate you today, and I want to show you that child malnutrition is an issue that we all really need to work together to resolve. So to start with, I'm going to give you a brief introduction to what child malnutrition is, how we define it, and how we measure it, so that you can get a better understanding of my study methodology, as well as highlighting some of the main findings of my study and what they mean, and how we can use them to further address this issue, both in India and throughout the world. So to start with the basics, what is malnutrition? It's defined as a pathology caused by a lack of essential nutrients. So the word pathology means that it's a disease process. It can be clinically diagnosed, and it's measured biologically. And it's caused by a lack of essential nutrients. So this means that we need to look beyond food intake. It's not just about a lack of food. It goes deeper than that. And malnutrition can be manifested as underweight or overweight. In developed countries, we typically see this manifested as overweight or obesity. But in developing countries, we see the opposite problem. And this is because of a lack of both caloric and nutrient intake. So now that we know how to define malnutrition, how do we measure it? Well, there are three main indicators. Stunting, wasting, and underweight. So stunting is defined as low height for age, and this is measured by taking a height measurement. Wasting is defined as low weight for height, and we measure this by calculating the body mass index, which is a calculation that incorporates both height and weight. Underweight is defined as low weight for age, and this is done by taking a weight measurement. And underweight is a composite measure of both stunting and wasting. So it's often used as a quick measure to assess the extent of malnutrition in a population. So when we measure an individual, we have to compare them to some reference population to determine their nutritional status. And this is done by using a growth curve. Now for my study, I used a reference population established by the Centers for Disease Control here in the United States. So the midpoint of this curve represents the 50th percentile, which is defined as average growth. And clinical malnutrition is defined as growth below the 5th percentile, which is highlighted by the red section of this curve. So how does malnutrition affect the individual? We can see here that we use statistics and measurements to understand the prevalence, but how does it really affect a person? Malnutrition is very closely tied to poverty in a cycle. So someone who's poor is more likely to be malnourished because they're not likely to be able to afford enough food. And someone who is malnourished is in turn predisposed to poverty. This is because malnutrition impairs both physical growth and cognitive development. And this means that a person will have less energy to perform their daily activities because of lack of physical growth. And because of the impaired cognitive development, they may not perform as well in both school and work settings. And this may be linked to lower income earning throughout the lifetime, which may result in poverty. So these are the consequences of malnutrition. But what are some of the causes? Causal factors of malnutrition exist on multiple levels, as you can see with this diagram. And there are multiple causes which are all interlinked, making this a complex etiology. Religious beliefs, cultural norms, and the availability of social services on a broader societal scale affect the access that families have on the household level to foods and health services. And these household level factors, in turn, affect the child on an individual level. This affects the food that's put on a child's plate and ultimately impacts the child's health and nutritional status. So you can see that all of these causal factors on multiple levels ultimately affect the end result of child nutritional status. So you might be wondering, how bad is child malnutrition? malnutrition, where does it exist in the world? This map displays the hotspots of malnutrition throughout the world, and it is a global problem as displayed by this map. The majority of child malnutrition exists in Africa and South Asia, and 150 million children throughout the developing world below the age of 5 are malnourished. 78% of these children live in South Asia. The highest areas of prevalence are displayed by the darkest colors in this map. And within South Asia, the majority of malnourished children live in India. So I'll just give you a second to look at the map. So in the developing world, 28% of children under the age of 5 are malnourished. But for India, 46% of children under the age of 5 are malnourished. So you can see that it's significantly higher. And combined with India's huge population size of over 1 billion people, this has severe consequences at a national level. And this is because malnutrition impairs cognitive development. This means that people will be earning less during their lifetime. So this has severe economic effects on a national level for India. And because India is a key player in our global economy, this affects everyone. So now let's narrow down and take a closer look at India and look at recent trends in child malnutrition. These bar graphs display national level data collected between 1992 and 2006. And the main trend we see here is that over this period of 14 years, there hasn't been a significant decrease in child malnutrition in India. It's important to note that India has the largest program in the world that is aimed specifically at addressing child health and child nutrition. It's called the Integrated Child Development Services Scheme, and it was started in 1973. So it's been around for more than 30 years. And given the presence of such a wide national level program, we would expect to see better trends for child malnutrition over this period of time. So you can see the three indicators that I mentioned that we use to measure child nutritional status: stunting, wasting, and underweight. And you can see here that underweight and stunting have actually decreased a certain amount, but wasting has actually increased in this period of time. And this is definitely a trend that we don't want to see. In addition, recent research within the past 5 years has actually found that the highest rates of child malnutrition in India exist in urban slum communities. It was previously thought that this was existing in rural areas because, as you may have heard, in many countries throughout the world, people living in rural areas have less access to healthcare services and education. But recent research has found that the urban slum populations actually have higher rates of malnutrition. And there are many cities that haven't yet been studied because this is a recent finding in research. Many disciplines have taken a close look at child malnutrition because it is an interdisciplinary issue. Epidemiology has found that caloric intake doesn't tell us everything we need to know. We need to look at nutrient intake, as well as the way that food is distributed amongst members within the household. This ties in with the finding from economics that parents tend to invest in specific children who they feel will thrive. And this may cause them to bias against other children in the family and not provide them with the same amount of food and nutrition. Research from psychology has found that women are the primary caretakers of children and are the ones who make most of the decisions in the household about food purchase and preparation. And this is the case not only in India, but in many countries throughout the world. And the factors that affect the decisions that women make when they buy foods are determined by local cultural beliefs about good foods. And this is evident in anthropological research. So these are very important findings to consider when you're looking at child malnutrition. And I use these findings to create my main research aims. So first off, I wanted to measure child malnutrition in India because it is the area where this issue is of highest prevalence. And within India, I wanted to focus on urban slums because that's where it's most prevalent in India. And I wanted this study to be an exploratory study to serve as a starting point for further research on this issue. So I wanted to identify multiple causal factors on many levels. If you remember the framework with the triangle, I wanted to identify factors on each of those levels: societal, household, and individual levels. and I felt that it would be important to focus on mothers as a primary source of information because they're the ones who are primarily taking care of children and making decisions about food and keto. So to accomplish these three research aims, I chose Bangalore, India as my research setting. And Bangalore is also my hometown, so I do have a personal connection to it, and I know the local language, so I felt that this would really facilitate the research process. And Bangalore is the fifth largest city in India, and it has experienced really high rates of recent economic growth. And this is particularly in the IT sector. It's actually known as the Silicon Valley of India. But despite this high recent economic growth, child malnutrition has not been studied in detail in this particular region. So I felt that by studying this area, I could contribute a lot of valuable knowledge. And I wanted to include both quantitative and qualitative methods in my study because I felt that they complement each other well and provide a holistic understanding of the problem. So I incorporated quantitative methods in my study by measuring nutritional status of children and incorporated qualitative methods by following that up with interviews with mothers to identify some of the main potential causes of child malnutrition in this population. So my first step was to measure the nutritional status of urban slum children, and I ended up measuring 974 children, and I divided them into adequately nourished and undernourished groups. And then I selected some mothers for interviews from these two groups, and then compared the findings between these two groups. The way that I was able to access my population was by working with a local non-governmental organization called Parikrama Humanity Foundation. Parikrama provides free education to urban slum children in Bangalore, and they actually have four different schools throughout Bangalore. So I was able to access all four of these schools, so that made my sample more representative of the city as a whole. So I wanted to show you pictures from the data collection process to give you a visual for all of these methods. The picture on the left is actually, this is the equipment that we use to measure height. It's called a height board. And we use digital weighing scale to measure weight. And the quantitative data was analyzed using statistical software. And my advisor, Dr. Zemel, helped a lot with that. And then maternal interviews were conducted, and this is actually a picture of one of the mothers who I interviewed. And the maternal interviews were about a variety of topics. We talked about family demographic information, the ways that mothers perceive their own health, cultural food beliefs and nutrition knowledge, and the amount of social support that mothers had, a whole variety of topics. So I was able to gather a lot of data from these methods. And a lot of really important findings came out of this. And because this was a mixed method study, the findings naturally split themselves up into quantitative and qualitative. So I'll give you a second to just look over them. So the quantitative findings came from the child nutritional status measurements conducted of the urban slum children, as well as the demographic information collected on the 44 families through the maternal interviews. And the qualitative information came from my own observations when I was walking around the slum areas, as well as the responses of mothers during the interviews. So I'll go into each of these findings in detail now. So as I mentioned, there hasn't been a comprehensive study of child malnutrition in this population before. So this was the first study to really look at this issue. And the result was that we found that there was a high prevalence of child malnutrition here. And this, you can see the three pie charts here for each of the three indicators that we use to measure malnutrition. And the red sections represent the percentage of children who would be defined as clinically malnourished. That is under the fifth percentile of the growth curve. The blue sections represent the percentage of children who would fall under the 50th percentile, that is below average growth. And the green sections represent the percentage of children would fall above the 50th percentile or above average growth. So if we take the example of weight, you can see that 46% of children, almost half of the children who were measured, would be diagnosed as clinically underweight, clinically malnourished. This is a really significant percent of children. And if we only 8% of children were diagnosed as below average growth. And if we combine both the red and blue sections, this means that 94% of children in this population had below average weight. This means that child malnutrition is a very important issue to address in this community. Aside from these findings here, we also conducted analyses comparing boys and girls. And we found that there was no gender trend for height and weight, but for BMI, we actually found that girls were doing better than boys. And this is kind of counterintuitive because you hear so much about how there's a gender bias against females in Indian society with female infanticide and other things like that. So this is definitely something to look further into to investigate why there's this gender difference. So the statistical analyses were useful for both identifying the prevalence of child malnutrition in this population, as well as to identify how the demographic variables of families affected child nutritional status. So when we compared the adequately nourished and undernourished groups of families, there were a few variables that really differed between the two groups. Family income was the variable that differed the most. So the children who were adequately nourished, their families had a significantly higher family income than the children who were in the undernourished group. And this is displayed by both of these charts here on the bottom. The chart on the right is BMI, and the chart on the left is BMI, and the chart on the right is height. These are both measures of nutritional status, and basically they show the same trend, that as household income increased, child nutritional status improved. And this is displayed by the line with the positive slope. And other variables were also found to be important, specifically the frequency of father's employment, father's education, and father's age. So the children who were from the adequately nourished families had fathers who were employed more frequently, had higher levels of education, and were older. So this concludes the quantitative findings from my study. And I'd like to switch gears now a bit and talk about the qualitative findings. And the themes that are addressed with the qualitative findings have to do with environmental risks, maternal food beliefs and nutrition knowledge, child intake, and the role of mothers and fathers within the household. So when I was walking around the slums, I noticed a lot of environmental hazards. These are just some pictures that I took when I was walking around the areas. So there wasn't really a proper way to dispose of trash in this community. You would often find them in the streets. And the slums had an open drainage system for sewage. So the sewage from all of the homes would collect in the central pit. And this pit was to flush out all the sewage from the community. But the problems really started when these sewage pits would overflow during the monsoon season. And basically, this sewage would be strewn all over the streets and on occasion into some of the homes that were located close to this open drain. So this presents a huge environmental risk for all of the families in this community. And another problem was that you would have to cross over this drain to exit and enter the community. So everyone would be put at risk. And this is actually a picture of a child who's on his way to school. And he had to cross over this twice a day. So you can only imagine the kind of health consequences. And for the picture on the right, as I mentioned, there wasn't a way to properly dispose of the trash in this community. So many people would just throw the trash into this open pit, thinking that it would be flushed out along with the sewage. But instead, it would actually make the problem worse because it would clog the drain and make the flooding and spilling of sewage in the streets exacerbated. So these environmental hazards were very visible. And in addition to environmental hazards, the housing conditions in these areas were also substandard. The picture on the left shows one of the homes where I conducted an interview with one of the mothers. And I just remember when I was going to this home, it seemed like a maze to me. I would not be able to find my way out on my own. And the amount of space in between homes was less than 2 feet. So it was a very cramped environment and very hard to walk in and out of this community. And the picture on the right represents a home for five people. This is it, just one room. It's for a family with two parents and three children. And the three kids would sleep on the bed, and the parents would sleep on the floor. And the real problem started when it rained, because the walls and ceilings in this house would leak. And then the parents who were sleeping on the floor couldn't sleep at night because of this. So these environmental conditions and housing conditions really made life very difficult for these families. And it made it very hard for them to stay healthy. Environmental risk factors and crowded housing conditions are very much linked to increased risk of infection. Now there's a concept called the malnutrition infection syndrome, which talks about how malnutrition and infection are linked in a cycle. And this graph displays this concept visually. So the line that you see on the top represents the growth trajectory of a healthy child from birth till age 3. And the line on the bottom represents the growth trajectory of one particular child who has experienced repeated episodes of illness. So what's happened here is every dip that you see in the graph represents a particular illness occurrence which has caused the child to lose weight. And because the child has experienced a subsequent illness after that, the child was unable to regain the weight. And over a long period of time, this creates a gap here, and this results in the child becoming malnourished. So malnutrition and infection are very much closely linked. And in addition to these environmental factors, there were also cultural factors that were having an effect on child nutritional status. So when I was talking to mothers during these interviews, just talking about how they think about food, how they understand food, and how they classify food, it was evident to me that they don't think about food in the same way that we do here in the United States, you know, based on calories, carbs, and proteins, and things like that. It's based on a cultural model, a belief system based on the hot and cold qualities of foods. So mothers categorize foods into hot and cold categories. And this belief was based on an understanding that foods had, not based on the physical temperature of the food, but based on an inherent quality that when you ate a specific food, it would either have a heating or cooling effect on your body. And mothers believed that you had to balance both hot and cold within your body, as well as between your body and the environment. So this meant that they would avoid hot foods in the summertime and avoid cold foods. And mothers classified rice as a cold food. And rice is a staple food in South India. It makes up a majority of the diet. So this means that when children were sick, mothers would not give their kids rice because they felt that it would make the illness worse. And when this makes up the majority of the diet, this brings up the question, well, is this caloric deficit being replaced by another food, or what's really going on here? And in addition, mothers felt that meat caused too much heat in the body, so they would avoid giving this to their children. And this virtually eliminates the main source of protein in the diet. So this hot and cold belief system definitely has implications for child nutritional status. And you can take a quick look at this chart, the credentials that that person did or didn't have. So this really brings about doubt regarding the knowledge that mothers do have and the validity and usefulness of that knowledge. There's a definite need to improve maternal nutrition knowledge in this community because mothers weren't able to discriminate between foods based on their health value. And in talking to mothers, they also mentioned they felt very scared because their children were not eating enough. They felt this. They said that their children were not finishing the food on their plate. And this is a really alarming finding because as it is, these families are very poor and they can only afford a small amount of food. And even within this small amount of food, if the children are not finishing it, that's definitely something that needs to be looked into. So if you remember the multi-level causal factor model from before, this is a specific example of how this model applies to low child intake. So there are societal factors that are affecting and specifically limiting the amount of food that families have access to. There's a system called the ration card system in India, similar to the food stamp system here in the United States. And it basically is meant to give families who fall below the poverty line access to subsidized foods. But the problem is that the system is very corrupt, and there's a lack of accountability of government officials who are running the system. And basically, families who should have access to it don't. So it's not really helping them. And when I was speaking to mothers, many of them complained that food prices had just skyrocketed, and this really reduced the amount of food that they could afford for their families. So inflation was playing a key role here. A study conducted by the World Bank found that between 2005 and 2008, food prices in India had risen by 12%. That's huge. I mean, for families who are at the poorest sections of society, that has a huge impact on what they can afford. So those are the societal factors that may be affecting the amount of food that families can bring into the house and put on the child's plate. But there are household and individual level factors that are affecting how much the child actually eats. So the approaches that parents take to child feeding during mealtime, how much attention they pay to the child, whether they scold the child or encourage the child, whether they eat with the child or separately, all of these factors affect how much a child eats. And in addition, the choices that parents make regarding which foods to buy, whether they buy a large variety of foods or stick with a few main foods that they tend to buy on a weekly basis, this also affects how much the child eats. And these factors, in turn, affect the child on an individual level. Many mothers stated that their children were distracted during mealtime. They just wanted to go outside and play with their friends and didn't really care about eating. So this is likely to have reduced how much they ate as well. And if you remember back to the malnutrition infection syndrome, if a child has an illness, their appetite may be reduced because of just decrease in appetite or diarrhea or vomiting, other consequences of the illness. And if that appetite is never regained, if it's not brought back to the normal level, the child may continue to be eating less. So all of these factors may be causing low child intake. And you can definitely see how this would have a very direct link to child malnutrition. So when I was talking to mothers, they also told me a lot about how family members have differing roles within the household. So mothers had to take care of everything related to the child. I mean, like daily activities like bathing and getting the child ready for school, as well as the child's health and schoolwork, helping them with homework, all of these things, preparing and purchasing food for the family, managing the household expenses, and working to help earn income for the family as well. And the main complaint of mothers was that they felt a lot of tension and stress in their lives in balancing all of these multiple roles. And every single mother that I spoke to, all 44 of them, complained of some kind of health problem, whether it was just from headaches to chest pain and stomach pain on a daily basis, more serious things. And it was clear to me that these mothers were always putting themselves last. They always felt that, you know, I need to put my child first, or I need to put my husband first, and they deserve care before me. But the reality is that if a mother has so many health problems of her own, her ability to take care of her child gets limited because of it. So this is likely affecting child nutritional status in that way. And mothers also felt that they didn't have support from anyone. They weren't able to depend on anyone or rely on anyone to help them with these problems they were facing. And when I asked mothers about fathers, they said that fathers were not very involved in family activities and rarely helped with any child care activities. And their main role in the family was to earn money. And this is likely to tie in with the findings from the statistical analysis, if you remember, the three factors that came up as significantly different between the undernourished and adequately nourished groups were fathers' employment frequency, fathers' age, and fathers' education. So these may be affecting how much money a father is able to earn. And there was a very high prevalence of paternal alcoholism in this community as well. And mothers complained that because their husbands were spending money on alcohol, this was taking away from the money that could be spent on food and health. healthcare for the family. So this has been a summary of the main findings of my study. So how do you make sense of all this? What does it all mean? Well, some common themes that we see are that child malnutrition has causes on many levels. And these causes are interlinked, which makes it complex. And many of the factors that I've identified are likely to be specific to the context of Bangalore, because they're dependent on local, cultural, and environmental factors. And during this entire research process and reflecting back upon my findings, there were several potential interventions that came to mind. I feel that addressing maternal nutrition knowledge is very important, because mothers are the ones who are doing all the purchasing and preparation of food for these families. So if they have more knowledge, they can be more informed consumers. And with the limited budget that they have, they can make better choices that are likely to benefit their families more. And improving maternal health is important in and of itself, because women and everyone should be healthy for the sake of being healthy. But the impact that maternal health has on child nutritional status is also important. So improving maternal health is likely to have a beneficial effect on the family as a whole, as well as child nutritional status. And if you remember from the statistical analyses, it was found that children with higher or better nutritional status had fathers who were employed more frequently. So by increasing the employment frequency of fathers who were not employed frequently, it's likely to help families have a greater income, which they can then use to improve their health overall. And mothers complained that the ration depots, the places where the ration cards were to be used, were not accountable and there was a lot of corruption there. So if there are any interventions that could address this issue, it's likely to give families greater access to the services that they deserve. So how can you all get involved? That's the real question. That's why you're all here, right? So child malnutrition is really an interdisciplinary issue, and we all need to work together to address it, because it's based in social causes and it's complex. So there are many areas for further research that many disciplines can contribute to. Anthropology can contribute by analyzing this hot and cold belief system based in cultural attitudes to understand how this is really affecting intake and nutritional status. Psychological studies could focus on behavior of both parents and children during mealtime to see what kind of practices and behaviors may be contributing to low child intake. Economic studies could see how resources are divided amongst family members within the household and what impact this may be having on nutritional status of children. And also they can investigate the gender difference that was observed. Nutritionists could take a closer look at the diet of this community and see where it's falling short. Are there deficiencies? What is the energy density of the food? And where are nutritional needs not being met? Sociological research could look at the demographic factors of these families and see what might be influencing child nutritional status. And epidemiologists could take a look at how infection may be linked to malnutrition, as well as how it may be linked to the environmental risks that were mentioned. And potential interventions could be designed to improve the environmental status of the community and thereby improve health. So in conclusion, I just want to emphasize that this is really an issue that you all can get involved in. And to address it, it is a complex issue, and to address it, we all need to work together and come up with solutions that can address this complexity. So thank you for listening and for coming, and I'd like to thank the CWiC advisors who have worked with me throughout this semester to put together this presentation. Thank you so much for all your time and effort. And thank you to Sue for coordinating this event. And thank you to Dr. Zemmel and Dr. Hall, who I don't think is here, my two advisors who coached me throughout this research process. It's been great. Thank you. Areas of
Do you have any idea as to what was the sample or what was the population on which the CDC control curve was made? Because if it's like made... Yeah, I mean, because if you use an American curve for Indian standards, then you will automatically find that most of the areas are not that.
That's a debate.
And especially with babies.
Right.
That's true.
That's true. That's very true. That's a debate that's going on in this field right now. So the CDC curve is based on a U.S. population, and it's supposed to be nationally representative. And it is based on the United States, and there's a debate as to whether that can be used to used as a reference for measuring populations from other countries. But the fact is that there isn't anything better out there right now, and that's all we can use. The World Health Organization is developing an international reference, and they are actually taking part of the sample from India for that. But that's currently not available for the age group which I used. It's only available for children under the age of 5. So I wasn't able to use it for this study, but maybe in the future. Dr. Zem?
I just want to add a comment to that question. When they developed when the CDC developed the growth charts, they excluded the weights of children from the recent surveys in the United States. So they used data from children going back into the 1960s in the U.S. So they excluded children who were over the age of 6, where you start to see an increase in prevalence of obesity. So when you use those charts, even on American populations, you find that they have high weight because it's really an ideal BMI or weight distribution rather than what U.S. children actually have today.
I think that one way to get around this would be to compare Indian children or brown children here under the age of 6 on the same curve and then see what percentage of children turn out to be malnourished and then compare that rate to the rate that she actually finds. So do
what
control.
Percentage of US children are below the curve?
What percentage of, say, brown children in the US fall below the curve and then compare that to the rate that she finds? So do some sort of controlling, because if you think that the curve is actually representative and children under 5 don't fall under the obesity group. So then maybe there's some sort of a control study where you take the control from the same genetic group here and then compare it to those results. That might give you a better estimate of what the obesity rate is. But yeah, I mean, it's a big step. So.
I have a question. You mentioned in the previous slide that between 2005 and 2008, food prices in India went up by 12%.
Mm-hmm.
How much did an average household income go up? Did it go up as much as that, or is it lower? Or is that also skewed because of so much GDP growth, but then obviously you still have a great amount of population still living in
I honestly don't know the answer off the top of my head, but I have a paper record slide it, so I can get back to you. Looked at the city where I was born in this way, and I was just shocked to find how bad health really is.
to the school in that community, is there, do they receive food at school?
They do.
And it's free, or they have to buy?
It's free, everything's free. They receive 2 meals a day and like a protein shake at the end of the day before they go home. But since the majority of the child's nutritional status is determined by the age of 2, the food that's given to these children when they're already past the age of 5 has limited effect on their nutritional status.
And you pointed out about in terms of knowledge, mm-hmm. and depending on who that comes from in terms of mother's knowledge and application, is there anything on the horizon in terms of let's get out there and educate moms in poorest neighborhoods? Is there anything happening in that regard? Or?
So I'm still in touch with the non-governmental organization that I've worked with. And I've sent them my thesis, and they're very interested in improving health, but they have limited resources as well. So I'm trying to work with them to come up with an intervention that would be feasible. And my idea is to focus on prevention. So to prevent this extent of malnutrition from occurring in the next generation of children that are born in this community. So my idea was to target teenage girls who are students at their schools, and educate them about nutrition. Not really focused on prenatal nutrition or pregnancy, but just general nutrition, so that they have the knowledge that they need to improve their own nutritional status, so that by the time they get pregnant and have a baby, the baby's already at a better stage than it would be otherwise. And also, they would be more informed mothers. So after the child is born and when they have their own families, they can make better choices for their own families and for themselves.
So generally, in their curriculum, mm-hmm. the primary or secondary, it's not as important?
No, definitely not. There isn't really a health curriculum at all. And nutrition is not something, very generally speaking, it's not something that's considered important in, I can't say Indian society in general, but in Bangalore, at least from my experience, it's not something that's considered important. Even when I went to work at the NGO, they were wondering, like, why are you doing this? What are you going to get out of this? What's the point? So now I think I have a pretty good case to show them that it is something that needs to be addressed. Yeah. Shane?
Just a question in term, regarding the internal psychology as it pertains to food. Is there, or do you know, and I know you may not have time to tease this out, but why is there such a bias towards the classification of food? Is it something, you know, in the evolution of the psychology of, you know, maternal women in India? Is it just what they learn as?
Do you mean the hot and cold classification?
Yes. In that, why are they classifying food this way? Is there something that they learn as they go along the way? Because if you're going to change someone's psyche, you need to know what about it that led them down this path that you need to correct. Because sometimes just giving information
doesn't help. Right. Well, from my understanding, and I haven't researched this in depth, but from my understanding, it's a cultural belief system. So it's not just in this population that I studied. It's on a broader level in India as a whole. And I believe that it's based in Ayurveda, which is a predominant culturally based health system in India. And Ayurveda focuses on the balancing of both the body between the environment and balancing of elements within the body. So it kind of draws from that notion. So that would be my guess. And I think it's important also to mention that it's not really about changing their beliefs, but it's about helping them to understand the effect that what they're doing is having on nutritional status, because ultimately they want their children to be healthy too. So by just showing them, well, you're missing this in your diet, or because you're choosing not to include this food, this is the consequence it's having for your child. Just educating them in that way, not trying to change the cultural belief as a whole.
A question in regards to the perception of children measured 974 children. Did they ever at once talk to you about what's going on in their household, how they perceive their parents, maybe the disease state of their mother, the stress level that they're enduring?
Honestly, they didn't have enough time to tell me all those things, because I measured all the children in the schools, so I would take one child out of class at a time to make sure they didn't miss too much class time, and just measure them and send them back in. So I didn't have a chance to talk to them. the one that runs these schools. They're the ones that open the schools and have created them to cater specifically to the urban slum community. But there are definitely affluent populations in Bangalore as well.
I agree that I think your gender difference finding is really interesting.
Yeah.
I guess the way your data is organized, you probably can't do this, but it'd be interesting to see if that kind of persists controlling for family factors, like maybe for all the girls having been families that are smaller with fewer children, or do you have the other?
So for the 44 families, for the 44 mothers I interviewed, I did collect demographic information only on those families. So I didn't collect on all of the 974 children, because that would have taken forever. But we did do analyses on all of the factors that were collected, and family size was one of the factors that we analyzed, and there was no significant difference within that small sample size. But if you look at a bigger sample, you might find something different.
Do you have the population estimates for India in the next, like, 40, 50 years? I think in 2050, there's supposed to be 1.8 billion people in India. It's supposed to be by far the largest country in the world.
Yeah.
How do you deal with malnutrition? Mother just having more babies, and there's just so many people. And so many people. Is it like a one child policy? Like in China, is that something that India should explore?
There have been controversies and debates about that in India, definitely, because I mean, it's seen as infringing on the rights of people to have a one child policy. But it's a really important question, and I'm not sure that I can justify it with a good answer. But what I can say is that, because the population size is increasing so rapidly, it's important to really get on the ball about addressing this issue, because it's only going to get worse as the population increases. And it does, as I mentioned, it takes a multifaceted and interdisciplinary approach. And working with, I know that public health professionals who deal with population health and family health and reproductive health have specific interventions that focus on talking to families about family planning and family size and things like that. So perhaps to bring that in along with interventions related to child malnutrition might help address that.
First of all, I forgot to ask the last time I was saying. Thank you though for explaining all this information to us, because definitely very, very valuable information I'm glad you'll share with all of us. My question was about your slide with the triangle, upside down triangle, if you might want to go back to it possibly.
This
one right here, yeah.
Okay.
Which one of these sets of factors, you know, in your humble opinion, do you think might have the interim solution the most amount of impact towards the children? Just curious. Well, and not only that, also practicality also, right?
Right.
So societal factors might be a lot more difficult to change or better versus an individual factor.
I definitely think that focusing on the household level is important. And for, you know, purposes of time and constraints, there are things that I didn't include in this that could be playing a role. And energy density of food, it's a very technical concept, but I'll try to explain it to you. I actually feel my hunch is that that's probably having the biggest impact on reducing child intake here. If you know anything about the South Indian diet, rasam is a very commonly eaten food, and it's basically like a soup, but it's very watery. And in this particular population, they often didn't put vegetables in it either, so it was very watery. And this is what they ate almost on a daily basis. So the concept of energy density basically means that if a food is watered down, the number of calories that it has is lower, but it fills you up faster because the volume is large. So because these children and these families are eating this on a regular basis, my hunch is that that might be what is causing children to eat less, because they're eating these foods that are low in energy density, and this would fall under the household diet category. So,
but then that would be related to the interview on the head and the body. One loss of being able
yeah.
that we don't have that much money to better buy so much food. So.
Right, and it's definitely related to income, but also knowledge. Just knowing what foods are energy dense and not energy.
And employees are now, income would still, I would say,
yeah, income is definitely the ultimate.
Pinpointing one level would be very difficult for us.
Yeah, that's why we need to take a multifaceted approach. Yeah. So
you mentioned that this kind of analysis has not been done in Bangalore, that is why you showed Bangalore. So if it's been done for other cities and other urban slums, let's say in North India or areas where
I actually haven't started with that more developed in terms of energy density. Do you think vegetarianism, the prevalence of vegetarianism more in the southern states versus the northern states make a big difference?
So that's definitely true that there's more vegetarianism in the south, but it all comes back to income because meat is expensive. So these families, the majority of them were forcibly vegetarian because they couldn't afford meat. If they were able to buy it, they only ate it once a week. So that's as good as being vegetarian. So I don't think that I don't think there would be such a difference between north and south in that way. And I imagine that slum families living in the slums in North India would have the same problem in terms of being able to afford meat. But in terms of studies that have been done in North Indian slums, to my knowledge, no one has taken quite the approach that I've taken with this study in terms of focusing on a broad range of factors. There are studies that have looked specifically on diet, specifically on parental attitudes and practices during child feeding, specifically on the relationship of income. So there are studies that have addressed narrowly each of the factors that I've highlighted, but nothing that has taken a comprehensive approach. So it'd be interesting to replicate this model in other cities in India and see what the differences are.
Did you get to interview these people from Parikrama? Is it like a very focused education kind of based organization? Did you interview any of them as to what kind of perspective that they have in terms of do they have a goal in terms of what are they doing with their programs or what is this education, where is it leading to? Do they have a mission or a goal? Or
I actually had a little bit of difficulty in being able to talk to the upper level management staff. But from my narrow understanding, they're trying to increase income in the subsequent generation by providing education. And so currently they have education until 10th grade, and they actually just acquired land to build a Parikrama college. So they are also giving vocational training to children who don't pass the exams to go on to college. So they're trying to do whatever they can to increase income, and they're hoping that will ultimately improve the life of the subsequent generation. But they don't have too much of a direct focus on health. It's all focused on education as of now. Any other questions?
Right. Thank you all again for coming. On behalf of the Emerging Scholar Talk Board, we wanted to present Lavanya with this token of our appreciation. We have forced her all semester to come meet with us once or twice a week, and every time we give her feedback on her presentation, she's put in hours and hours and hours of work and has been so patient and so enthusiastic in this whole process. So we're so pleased that she did such an excellent job and has helped all you to gather an understanding of this topic. So thank you all for coming in.